Hi, it's Carrie. I'm a health professions librarian at Towson University's Albert S. Cook Library. In this video, I'm going to give a brief overview of the differences between a systematic review and a scoping review. I'll also provide some guidance for those of you who are hoping to undertake a scoping review. You may have heard of scoping reviews before, but when is it appropriate to do one? What are the biggest differences between a scoping review and a systematic review? And what do authors of scoping reviews aim to achieve? You may have already watched my video on systematic reviews. Systematic reviews typically answer very precise or very specific questions, traditionally those regarding clinical effectiveness. A systematic review's goal is to uncover all the existing evidence to inform policy and practice. A systematic review will produce statements that guide clinical decision-making. A systematic review topic may be guided by the PICO framework, that is, patient, problem or population, intervention or exposure, comparison or control, and outcomes. On the other hand, a scoping review may investigate a very broad topic. This may be an emerging topic or a topic where there isn't enough homogeneity in the field to perform a meta-analysis. A scoping review's goal is to identify key concepts and characteristics and make statements about knowledge gaps and future research. A scoping review may even be a precursor to a systematic review. A scoping review may be guided by the PCC framework, that is, population, concept, and context. Based on published, conducting, and reporting documents, a systematic review will have a protocol from which no deviations are encouraged. That protocol will be registered, ideally in Prospero, a protocol registration platform. The review's accompanying literature search aims to be as comprehensive as possible. Standardized data extraction forms are used. In a systematic review, critical appraisal or risk of bias assessment is mandatory. The result is a synthesis and summary of findings that can inform decision-making, policy, and practice. A scoping review should have a protocol, but it does not need to be registered. While Prospero does not accept scoping review protocols, OSF and Figshare may provide reasonable alternatives. A scoping review should also have a documented, comprehensive literature search, but risk of bias assessment is optional. Scoping reviews will make use of standardized data extraction tools to provide a summary of key concepts and an overview or map of the evidence. If you wish to perform a scoping review, there is methodological guidance available. Here are a few articles you may find helpful. In 2005, Arxie and O'Malley first wrote about the methodological framework used in a scoping review, encouraging authors to take the following steps. Identify the research question. Identify relevant studies through searching, select the studies, chart the data, and collate, summarize, and report the results. They had an optional sixth step, consult with stakeholders. In 2010, Levac et al. Built on the Arxie and O'Malley framework by providing context for each step and suggesting future improvements such as consistency in terminology and a more robust use of quality assessment. In 2014, Pham et al. Performed a scoping review of over 340 scoping reviews, identifying their key characteristics and practices. In 2020, Peters et al. Published an article, Updated Methodological Guidance for the Conduct of Scoping Reviews. There is also a chapter on scoping reviews in the JBI Manual for Evidence Synthesis. Both of these publications provide comprehensive guidance for conducting scoping reviews based on the latest trends and practices in evidence synthesis. Additionally, there is an extension of the PRISMA statement called the PRISMA-SCR. PRISMA stands for the Preferred Reporting Items for Systematic Reviews and Meta-Analyses, Scoping Reviews. The PRISMA-SCR can be found under extensions on the PRISMA statement website. The PRISMA-SCR, part of which is pictured here, provides a checklist for reporting your scoping review. Scoping reviews differ in the types of questions they answer. They also have different goals than systematic reviews do. I hope that you're able to learn something new from this video. Leave a comment down below and don't forget to subscribe to my channel if you find it helpful. Librarians are here to help, and I would be thrilled to hear from you.